Hey, it's Fran, again, and I'm in my car, because I've just arrived at the Vintage Computer Festival in Wall, New Jersey, and about to go in and take a look at some of the really cool exhibits in here, which there are many. Can't try to put this all in one video, and there's a lot of really cool things going on here today, which I'll be posting this week, and let's go inside and see what's going on.
So, the Center 5 Long Sheep Digital Teardown.
Yes.
This is her.
Cool.
Yeah.
Wait. Oh, can we do this? Wait. Turn it around here. Wait.
Yeah.
Oh, that's good.
Hi, this is
what
Brian.
What made you shoot you guys?
Brian.
Wait.
Are you going to do your thing?
Oh, okay. It's Fran. And
hi.
You know, this looks like part of the Saturn V, but I like the bell housing of the engine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They found that if they ran the fuel right down to the bell, that the lens would stay cooler, you know, during the ignition sequence.
I'll make sure that Sony knows that when I talk to them about the lens. So, but yeah, we're here to see the
Apollo.
The thing.
Cool.
The item.
Oh.
But it's hard to get out of the room once you got in the room. No, he knew a lot of those.
Oh, the segments on each display? Guess how they're controlled.
The segments on each display.
Relays.
Yes, I know that. Well, it's a high voltage display,
yeah.
So you know they didn't have.
It's going to simulate it with green LEDs and just.
No.
That's no.
That's not cricket.
See, I'm an engineer. I use modern technology.
No. We want to go.
Actually, see,
period.
Old school electronics, new technology.
There
so
we go.
I'm not afraid to simulate, or replace.
So what do you brought here today?
What did I bring?
Yeah.
On the table here is a bunch of the old Commodore computers from the 80s. This is Rob Clark's display. But these were, this is the first computer I was put in charge of back in 1984.
Commodore 116.
Yep. And this was Jack Tramiel. Said this is what you will make, and it was in response to the Timex Sinclair Spectrum, which was a color one. They were using Timexes. We like to use them for doorstops, anything like that. We have a lot of respect, as you can tell.
Dave is going to love the fact that the Sinclair is being used just to hold up the monitor.
Well, I used to hold my door open, you know, back at Commodore. But that came down from Jack Tramiel. So he had a strategy, and the strategy was don't compete with the Commodore 64, which had sold 27 million by that time, or throughout time, and he didn't want to compete with it. So then we ended up with a 264.
Is that too much?
Which is 64K. It has 121 colors, but it's not for playing games. It's for doing business. So the chip in that is called a TED chip, which means text display. So this is basically one of the first single chip systems where they had the sound, the video, the memory control all in a single chip. And then Jack Tramiel leaves. And we are left with a company that only knew how to sell a Commodore 64. And they really wanted to sell a Commodore 64, so they squinted real hard to make this into a Commodore. And they ended up selling it as a Plus 4. And so the only difference between the 264 and the Plus 4 is you have to sold for $79, and you tried to sell that one for $340.
$340
didn't sell very good. When they lowered the price to $79 and $49, these things were great. But Jack Tramiel was gone, and so it was almost like the company wandered around like this during that time. This is the last computer that Jack Tramiel ordained before he left and went to Atari.
And you've got some plug-in expanding games.
Yep. There weren't many done. Jack Attack was named after Jack Tramiel. There used to be what a Jack Attack was. At one point, he fired a whole bunch of management. It was kind of like killing the herd, you know, getting a sheep, you know, out of there. And after he left, nobody would come along and fire the middle managers. So we ended up with way too many middle managers running around trying to justify their existence.
So,
but Jack Attack was where he would go around firing people. Just for the hell of it. That's the urban part of it.
So how many games did they actually make for these systems?
Not many. Because, you know, it really wasn't a game machine. This one does have built-in software, the Plus 4. They try and do an editor.
That's
like,
right.
Reverse engineer. We didn't call it a spreadsheet.
Oh, right.
The one that started it all.
Yeah.
The pet.
Yeah.
Totally cool.
I'll show you the demo here.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, everybody does that. They engrave in.
Oh, yeah.
And then you can never get that out.
Yep.
Well, but it's prestigious. It's UC Berkeley.
Happy to UC Berkeley.
Yep.
I actually gave away a pet because it had some high school's name engraved.
Oh, yeah.
So you're actually, this is actually showing it,
it's doing it.
It's an ASCII, this is,
exactly, yeah.
So this is me on ASCII.
Exactly, yeah. This is your brain on ASCII.
Through
this
a brain, through a pet.
Exactly.
Now you're using a smartphone.
Using a smartphone, it's capturing video, chops it up into little bits and converts it to text, and then it sends it over Wi-Fi to a Raspberry Pi computer.
Which is on the side here, we got the Raspberry Pi.
And then that's sending it out over serial link.
Everyone on Adafruit will love that.
Yeah. It's very useful for old computers.
Exactly. Yeah.
And then sending it over serial to the 64.
And now we have a 64 too.
Yeah.
So, okay, so now I gotta see. This is, I gotta have myself on.
There you go.
Okay, so this is me on a C64.
Yep. Crazy color. Crazy color.
So you wrote the software for converting this?
Yeah.
So you're interested in Commodore, obviously, is profound.
I started out with the hacking on the PET because I found there was a computer warehouse in the Bay Area that was giving away some of these things a couple of years ago. So I got one. I didn't have a drive for it, so I made an SD card drive, and then kind of just ballooned out from there. And,
so you're from California. Okay. Welcome to New Jersey. Don't you feel great that you're
great.
Finally out of that terrible California?
Well, I grew up here.
Area.
I grew up here.
Oh.
For, you know, first 18 years, and then
well, welcome back.
Yeah, it's good to be back.
Show you this command.
This is obviously from the German wing of the Commodore German.
Yeah, I'll wait for Mickhouse.
Commodore TV game, 3000H. It says back control.
Yeah, it's a line to
serve. So it's like a.
Which they didn't.
It's a pong. It's a tennis game. So, interesting. Well, I'm in Commodore heaven. Look at all those Commodores. C64 is wall to wall. It's really cool. It's the VIC 101 with Japanese characters. So, such as. And this is cool. Look at this. It's a VIC 20.
With Japanese characters. So it's Japanese version of VIC 20.
Wow.
So basically what you have is Japanese characters on the keys, otherwise it's identical to the VIC 20.
So this Max then, you said this was only released in Japan.
Yes, it's a Max, or the Max machine. It's about half of the Commodore 64 shipped away. What is left is a game console. So it's only in Japan, and it didn't sell very well, so it's very rare now.
What year was that?
It was 82.
82.
The VIC 20 was 81, this is 82, Commodore as well was 82 as well.
Yeah. That's interesting. Zaxxon for the C64. So these are flash drive 1541 replacement flash drives, right?
Yeah. Is there a limitation to?
I've read about that for 1541.
I would say, you know, there's probably a collaborative effort. This is my hardware, and I originally had my own operating system.
system for it? For the C64-128, does it recognize the flash drive exactly the same way as it recognizes the floppy drive? Same access codes?
That's right. This drive operates at the file level, so if you do all the, you know, load, directory, change, you know, all those types of commands, it'll emulate those commands, and it'll emulate the loading of files and whatnot, and it does support images, so you could put a D64 image, mount an image, and then say, I want to go to track 18, and it'll know in the image where to go to find track 18, so that is
I do a lot of travel in the U.S., and I was just
finally in the with the computer, with the C64, and unfortunately I really don't have the time to code in by hand a bouncing ball program, although I would if I really had the time, but I really thought this would be the appropriate point to show the shirt that I've been wearing all day, which only like hardcore Commodore geeks would really even get. So here's the shirt. If anyone gets it, yeah, there you go. Get it? Black t-shirt with white lettering, and so the code writes, well, I'll let you C64 coders work that out. Just type that in, and by the way, that's a shift and the O key. Get that shift and O at the same time.